Welcome to countrylifeprojects.com. I'm Henry Reinders. This is video 13 of 15 videos in our shed project. In this video, I'm going to be showing you how to install a three-tab asphalt shingle roof. It's fairly straightforward. You just have to follow the steps in the videos, and I'm sure you won't have a problem. Okay, we're going to be getting started with our roof. Before we get going here, I just want to show you what shingle we're using. This is just a typical three-tab shingle. They are generally 36 inches long, 12 inches deep, and our tabs are 12 inches each, so 6 inches on center or 12 in between. When you're picking this material out, and you're at the lumber yard or your roofing supplier, paper packaging tends to show damage quite easily. Plastic wrap, because it tends to loosen up, it's very hard to see damage, so I recommend when you're picking out your material that you just run your hand around the perimeter of the packages. Just make sure you don't feel any dings or dents. Strapping from when these are bundled up and everything can leave marks in your shingles, which renders them useless. So take a little bit of time when you're picking them out. Like I say, paper wrap tends to show a little bit better, but again, check those as well. And as far as our roof goes, we've already done the first half of our roof. There's a reason for it. I want to show you a couple things. If you look up here, you'll see that I have screwed a 1-inch trim board on here, which is our overhang. We're going to use that for measuring and trimming if we have to. By doing that, you will notice on this side here how nice of an overhang you get. It's perfectly straight. We have a 1-inch overhang on our side, or eave, and it is equal. So when you look at it from this angle, it looks very good. So next I want to bring you up onto the roof. I'm going to show you a couple things we did purposely that you need to watch for. On this side here, I'm going to show you what we did with our starter strip, which is kind of a normal way to do it, but it's not the best way. This strip under here, which we put on first, is a full tile reversed. And as you can see, I can actually lift this shingle edge here. The way we're going to do it on the other side, so that you can see the difference, is we're going to go with a strip of tile cut from our shingles that has the tar strip here, which will allow this first row of shingles to adhere and prevent blow-up in the future. Makes it stronger. You can also go this way with that strip, but we'll show you that on the other side when we get there. The other thing on here, and I'll show you on this side, is you'll notice we don't have a 6-inch and a 12-inch start. We've actually had to balance it out on both ends. That's really important. Again, I'll show you how to lay that out on the other side. And on the roof, we have the shingle wrapped over. I'm going to show you as we get closer to the ridge why we're doing that. And so let's get started on the other side. Okay, we're up on the side of the roof where we're going to be doing the roofing and finishing this side off. Before we get rolling here, I just want to start with the roofing felt that we've used. It's already on. We've actually cut it just a little bit back from the edge of our fascia. So 1/8 inch to 1/4 inch roughly. That doesn't have to be perfect. You just don't want it overhanging. Kind of looks rough. On your roof. If it gets wet, it may bubble a little bit like that, but it's better than 15-pound felt, which if this got wet and it was 15-pound, it would look terrible and it's very hard to work with. You can also get roofing felts that are made from fiberglass and other materials that are resistant to water, and they won't do that at all. A little bit more money, but for a shed and for most houses really, number 30 felt is fine. It's a very thick material. Once you have that on, and I recommend that you use plenty of staples, you don't want this moving. You know, you will be standing on it at various times, so make sure you use enough staples. We've used 3/8 on here. That's about what you want. When you staple onto the lap here, or where there's double layers, 1/4 inch just won't cut it. So once you get that on, the next step will be to lay out your shingles. Now, in a lot of videos or instructional manuals, you know, you right off the bat, they talk about, you know, you start off with a 12-inch right flush with the overhang where you want it, and then you go 6 inches in on the next one. You know, if you are laying out your roof, in this particular case, if we were to do that, at that end there, we have a 1/2 inch left over. So there's no way you can actually secure a small strip at the end there. So in this situation, you want to find a balance between the two so you have an equal amount on both ends. So I've nailed this strip on here temporarily. And if you're working on your own, this is really handy because you can move the shingles back and forth while you're adjusting and trying to find out what the measurement's going to be. So in here, what I've done is I've moved this so I have 3 3/8 inch on the other end, and then with this tile here centered on the lower tab here, we have the exact same amount here, keeping in mind that this strip here is the actual end of our shingle. That's our 1 inch overlap there. So take your time and get this laid out. Try and get an equal amount on either end. If you have, say, 3 inches here and 4 3/4 down there, that's okay, but just make sure that the other side's the same way when you do it. So that done, we're going to take this off, and then we're going to start showing you how to lay out your starter course. One more thing though, once you have this figured out, I'm going to move this one out of the way. Once you have this figured out and you have your first shingle in place here, before you move it, mark off a line at the end here as your starting point. We're going to use that later for our layout. Okay, a couple more things before we actually get started with our layout. Quite often there's a lot of talk and controversy over this plastic strip that you see on the back of shingles. A lot of people think you have to remove that. Absolutely not. In fact, on a lot of shingles you'll actually see a label on here that says do not remove. This is strictly to keep your shingles, if you can imagine this all in a bundle, from sticking together. So from this tar layer sticking to there, you'd never get them apart if that wasn't there. And when you lay the shingles, you'll notice that this doesn't even interfere or come in contact with any of our shingle layers here. In fact, that is where your nails are going to be going through. So you lay this down at your 5-inch exposure right here, you can see that it's up here at the top of this shingle here, and this here has full contact with our tar layer. So do not take that off. If anything, it just adds a little bit of reinforcement underneath where your nail goes through. How much I can't say, but that's said to add some strength to it. And one other thing, this is a 30 degree angle roof. It's a 7/12 pitch, and as we get going on this video, safety should be number one concern. We're going to get about 3 or 4 rows up. I'll mention some of the safety equipment that you can buy for that. Also, if you go to our website at countryLifeProjects.com, under resources, we have a section on roof safety, the equipment you can buy, some of the things you should be looking out for, and videos that you can watch that address safety issues on the roof. Also, clothing. If you have an old pair of work pants, I definitely recommend using those. You start getting up here and sitting on this, it's going to get dirty. As far as shoes go, don't wear hard-soled shoes. It can rub against here when you're standing on the shingle, it can rub on it, and it will remove some of the asphalt on the face of it. So soft shoes is important. And generally, a 7/12 pitch is a lot steeper than you think. If you're standing up here, it's very easy to lose your balance, especially if you're not used to it. So definitely visit our website and read the safety information we have, check out some of the equipment and some of the videos. It's definitely worthwhile. Before we start our layout, we have to determine what the width of our starter strip is going to be. We'll be cutting those ourselves. So it's fairly simple. Just take a look at this shingle I got laid out here. You'll see we got our tar strip here. This is what we want near the bottom of our first run and at the edge of our fascia board. This line here, which has little notches here at the end where this line comes through, we're going to be cutting this first strip right here. So to do that, just flip the shingle over. Like I say, we got these notches on the ends here, plus we can use these two here. Just place a straight edge on there. Take your time to make sure these are accurate. And just score the back. Like I say, take your time. You don't need too many of these. And you just flip it over. The pieces will just drop off. We need four of these in a bit, so I'm going to make those. And the measurement for those here, 7 inches, is what this one works out to. So when we get up on the roof, I'll show you how we do that. And I'll finish that up, and then we can get going. We're going to lay out our starter rows and then our spacing. The first starter row here for our starter strip, we have a 7-inch starter strip. We want it to hang over 1/2 inch to 3/4 inch. In total, we're going to have 1 inch overhang with our primary layer of shingles, but we don't want the starter strip the same because we're cutting it ourselves. Could be some variations in the width, and if we were to try and make it the same, we would probably not get a nice line here. The nice line we're going to get with the main shingles is through a chalk line. And so the first thing we're going to do is we want a 1-inch overhang. Our shingles are 12 inches, so we're going to make our first mark at 11. Mark that off. And then our starter row are 7 inches, and I'm going to give them 5/8. As long as you're between 1/2 inch and 3/4, you're fine. We'll mark that. And then from this line here, we're going to go up as much as high as we can reach from our ladders. We're going to go up every 5 inches, which is what our exposure is going to be on our shingles. And then we can add more lines as we go up. I highly recommend that you chalk all these lines. We're going to repeat these measurements on the other end, and we're going to snap our lines, and that's going to give us nice straight lines with our shingles all the way across the roof. With 3-tab shingles, you also want to make sure you're centering and you have lines, vertical lines this way, to keep your shingles in line this way. Now, in the prior segment, I pointed out that I had marked off where our shingle is going to start. So from here, I'm going to go back a couple lines, 6 inches, and I'm going to go 6 inches this way. 6 inches is the center of each tab on your shingles. So I'll do that now. And we'll do the same thing on this side of this line. Right over to our last shingle. Put a good mark on there, it makes them easier to see. Now we're going to repeat these lines up at the peak or the ridge of the roof, and we're going to use those all the way through the whole installation. Why I'm doing so many here is that we're going to start at the bottom here. We're going to step back with our shingles so that we can work in one area and move our ladder and then do several rows in one shot. So we're going to do that. We're going to mark our lines down there, and we're going to snap these lines. It's fairly difficult to do on your own, so if you do have somebody that can help you, by all means, get their help. And we'll come back shortly once these are all marked off and start laying our shingles on so that you can see how this will all start to work together. Okay, we have all our lines marked out that we need to get started here. Our vertical lines go all the way to the ridge. The horizontal lines, we've gone as far as we can reach. I've nailed a block in here to hold my material. Make sure you use a couple of screws, otherwise it can flip out on you. We're going to start with our starter strip, which we pre-cut. We have a half inch overlap approximately. When you're nailing these, you want to stay up about 2.5-3 inches and about the same in. Double check you're lined up. We're flush with the outside of our spacer bar. You can see our lines here. We're going to have our open groove in our shingles between the tabs on those lines. So when you're nailing, make sure your nails aren't in those spots. Now, you'll notice this is our starting shingle line here. You'll see that I have this strip 5 inches back. Minimum is 4 inches. So we're going to carry through. Well, you can see we've got a lot of room. We're going to carry through to the end there. We'll have to put a little piece on the end. Nail the next piece in place here. Now I just want to mention a couple of things about the starter strip. You can use a couple extra nails on this, it doesn't matter too much. Never gets seen. Now I'm going to grab my starter piece, which I already have pre-cut. It's going to go here. You'll see that it extends just a little past our starter strip and is flush with the end here and is on our line here. Now, for a shed, this is fine, and even in some housing situations, you can see that the starter strip is up here about 2 inches. If you're in an area that you experience ice dams or you have really strong winds and rain, you may want to go to an alternate starter strip. And there's different kinds. There's actual material for ice dams that will come up about 24 inches. And then there's starter strips as wide as 17 inches. If you're concerned about that, check them out. The information on our resources on our websites, countrylifeprojects.com, has that information. Just check the resources section. And I'm going to finish off this row. Now I'm going to start the second strip, and then I'm going to show you the layout procedure so that you can keep working across the roof and do several rows at one time. Okay, before we go along too far here, I just want to point out the type of nail, the size of nail, well, type of nail as well. This is a standard roofing nail. This is 1.25 inches long. It will penetrate the shingle and protrude through the half inch sheathing by about 1/4 inch, which is what you want. You'll find where you might see instruction where people are talking about using 3/4 inch nails. Forget it. It's not only is it not correct, but when you're putting your nails on and you're nailing them, 1.25 inch allows you to be able to hold the nail like that and be able to give it a tap without worrying about banging your fingers. If that was 3/4 inch, 7/8 or an inch, that becomes more problematic. Chances are you're going to have some blue fingers by the time you're done. So that's number one. Your nails, 1.25, galvanized aluminum, or galvanized or aluminum, and a big head, 3/8 to 7/16. It's a typical roofing nail. And when we get to the ridge, we'll be using longer nails because by that time we'll have more layers of asphalt shingle to nail through. As far as where to nail, you want to have on the ends here a nail just below the tar line here, about 1 inch in. On our grooves here between the tabs, right above the line, the opening here, same here, and then 1 inch in over here. If you live in a high wind area, you would put a nail 1.5 to 2 inches on either side of this line here. That gives it a little bit of extra strength. So we're going to go ahead and nail that. Double check you're on your chalk line. That is the proper way to nail them. Now you can also use an air nailer if you have one. However, I personally prefer to do this by hand. With an air nailer, you can set them too deep depending on your air pressure. That's all stuff that would have to be adjusted. You can also, because the tendency is to work faster, not be as precise as to where the location of your nails go. Also, if your gun's on an angle or something along, you know, either way, this way, this way, or this way, and your nail goes in on an angle, that's not good either, because your nails do need to go in straight and flat, and you don't want to overnail them. You want to make sure they're solid, but not overnailed. And if they're on an angle, they can actually cut into the shingle or cut into the shingle above it. So nice and flat, not too deep, but solid. So I'm going to get the next piece for over here, and then I'm going to show you what we're going to be doing with our staging here, or stepping back, to allow us to work in sections as we go across the roof. It's very helpful when you're working on your own to be able to do it that way. As you can see, I've got the first of our shingles in to create our step here, and I'll show you in a minute what that's about. It's really easy for measuring. You just simply take your tape. Imagine these shingles aren't here. You take your tape from your spacer piece there. So you would put it there. You would measure over to your line. You'd do the same thing on the next one. Measure over and take those measurements. That one there and right through to that piece there. You just go down, cut them all square. I'll show you how to do that in a quick little video, or part of this video. And so that's one thing, that's ready to go. Now one thing I did not show you earlier that I have the opportunity to still show you is we did our starter strip down here, and it has our tar bead or tar line underneath here, which is going to allow these shingles to adhere to that. You can also, if you're concerned about wind on the ends of your shed, you can also put the same type of starter strip here. You'll notice on the back here that our plastic film is only about a half inch back. So when you do it on the ends, you only want to be about 3/8 of an inch over. And when you adhere it on the bottom here, our starter strip comes up to about here. This piece would overlap by about 2 to 3 inches, and you would nail it back about 2.5 to 3 inches as well. And you would run that right through to the peak of your roof, and then the top would overlap onto that. So that's a way to ensure the wind does not pull up on your end shingles here. I'm going to go ahead, move my ladder, and then I'll show you how easy it is to do these shingles with a stepped procedure like this. Okay, cutting shingles is not hard. It's similar to drywall in the way that you don't have to score it all the way through. A good sharp knife is definitely a must. You don't want the flimsy type of knife that, you know, with the break-off blades. This is much better. To do it, you want a 13-inch or 16-inch board, whatever you have, as long as it's wider than your shingle. Just let your shingle stick past the edge a little bit from the top end, and use a triangle square like this. It's my preference because it's got a nice beefy edge here. Just make sure it's flush there, put it on your mark, and just score through. You'll kind of get used to how deep or how hard you have to push. Just snap it, comes off, and then you have a nice clean line. This will give you a much better finish on the ends of your roof, on your overhang, and they'll be nice and square. And that's about all there is to it. One other quick note before I actually get started with that. The pieces that you cut off of your starter strip, your starter shingles over here, save them, because they will be usable on the other end. But let's get started dropping these into place. You're going to like this because you can stay in one spot, do 3 or 4 rows right away. Take your next piece, you can just drop it right on top. After this, you won't have to worry about spacing. for the remainder of the roof. Spacing this way, that is. Now before I put the next piece on, at this stage, there are roofing brackets that you can install, that you can mount on here, that will allow you to put a 2x10 along the length of your roof that you can stand on as you work up your roof. They would be nailed on at this point. Under our resource section on countrylifeprojects.com, under the roofing, we have information on those brackets. So just take a look under the safety section on roofing, you'll find them. We're just going to carry on here. We'll put the next piece on. And you would just carry on this way. This block here is actually going to interfere with the next piece, so I won't be able to put that on without removing it. So we can carry on with the ones we have. Okay, as you can see, the stepped process that we have over there carries on here, and it will do so on the next three strips. So we can just carry on through to the end. When you get to the point where you have to start cutting them, remember you can use the pieces you cut from that end over there, and then we just repeat this process. We'll chalk more lines, and we'll carry on, and it'll work its way up the roof. It's a very easy way to do it. You get a lot done in an area at one time. Okay, we've got to the end of our first rows here. And on the other end there, we cut our pieces to size to get our start. On this end, we just have our pieces that we have to fill in. It's very easy to do when you use the step procedure. You can measure a number of pieces at one time. You just simply measure from our spacer board we have on the end here, which is our 1-inch overhang. Take your measurement. We got 3 1/4, 9 1/4. If you have more rows, you could carry on and take those measurements. Go ahead and cut them like I showed you earlier. You'll notice that on this end here, with the procedure we use for finding where the shingles have to go, that the piece on the end here is the same width as the small pieces on the end there. When you put small pieces on the end like this, it's a good idea to put a nail not only at the bottom here, but put one up here as well. Reason for that, this is a small piece. You don't want it to cantilever out over your edge here later on in the future. So that's all you have to do there. Just put our next piece on here. So that completes these rows. From here on up, I actually prefer to be above my work going up. That way I'm not standing on my shingles. So we're going to finish the remainder of this. We're going to get up to the ridge. We get up there, I'll show you how we lap it over and then how we do our ridge caps. As far as the rest of this goes, just follow the procedure all the way up. Repeat your stepping process at that end. Work your way over. Fill in here. It's pretty straightforward from this point forward. Okay, we are now at the ridge of our roof. I want to show you how I did that. On this side here, we came up, overlapped it, comes down about 3 inches. We're doing the same thing coming up this side here. We're going to overlap it this way. By the time we have our ridge caps on here, that gives us 3 levels of protection. And to do that, because we don't have a chalk line here anymore, we just line this one up with the first one. And at the top of the groove here is where you place your shingle. And that's a 5-inch exposure. And just nail this on first, the same way you would nail shingles normally. Once you have that nailed, bend this over nice and snug. and nail this side down. You don't have to worry too much about where your nails are. The bridge cap covers everything. Remember to keep this nice and snug. You don't want your ridge caps peeking too much. At this point, 1¼ inch nails is still fine. When we do our ridge cap, we're going to use 1½ inch nails to compensate for the extra material that's on here. We're going to finish up to the end and get that done. Next, I'm going to show you how to do the ridge caps. They're really simple. And then we'll come back up and we'll start putting the ridge caps on. Next, I'm going to show you how to cut your ridge caps. This is where you can use up any of the pieces you have left over. What you want to do on this point here and here, on the end of your shingle here, is take a straight edge, triangle square works good, and just cut these pieces off. I'll show you why we're doing this in a second. You don't have to be too precise with your angles, as long as you go back on an angle. Just make up as many as you need for the roof. Now, why we cut these back, when these are laying on your ridge, and you're putting them together like that, if you still have this here, it would show up on the edge here, and it gives you a very unsightly line along the ridge of your roof. This way you never see it. You get a very nice clean finish. You also need to cut one strip, 5 inches, like that. That's going to be the piece you're going to use to finish the ridge cap at the other end. That's all there is to it. Cut as many as you need. Use up all your leftover pieces if you can. And we'll get started with the ridge cap next. Okay, we've got all our ridge caps cut and stacked up here. This handy little jig that they're sitting on is really simple to build. Just a 2x4 down here, chunk of plywood, and a 2x6 here. Keeps them all nicely stacked, which is important too, because if they're kind of like that in different places, they'll start sticking together. If you keep them stacked, so this plastic strip is on top of the tar strip, they won't stick together. But so to get going here, I'm going to show you how you figure this out. What you're wanting to do is get your cap with an equal amount of space on either side. So this exposure here is the same on both sides. Once you have that figured out, then what you need to do is snap a line down one side. Once you have that done, then you're pretty much ready to go. Now, one advantage of having this double layer folded over here is you get a bit of a rounded top here, which makes it nice for putting your ridge cap on. So, same way that we do our shingles, you nail behind or just below the tar line here. And in this case, we're using 1½ inch galvanized roofing nails. You line it up to the line and to the outside edge here. Lay it flat. Do the one side and then pull it over nice and tight. And nail the other side. Now the exposure on these is exactly the same as the roof. So simple way to do that. You no longer have any notches or grooves to give you that exposure. So instead of measuring each one, just cut a little stick and then you can just space them that way. Line it up to the line and nail the next one. And I would recommend keeping them about an inch and a half up to make sure you're nailing into the shingle below. Get it nice and tight, pull it over. Make sure it looks square. And then nail the other side. Now, before I continue on here, you'll see that I'm laying them this way, so the gap is here. There's a reason for that. Our wind comes from the opposite direction, so if it's raining and the rain is coming this way, then it's going to go across the top of our caps, not into them. If these were the reverse, the rain would be going inside and being forced in here. So these should be laid opposite to which way the wind and the rain generally hits your roof. I'm going to carry on here. I'm going to keep doing these exactly the same way. 5-inch exposure for these particular shingles. And the chalk line is an absolute must. It'll give you a perfectly straight ridge cap line all the way down your roof. Makes it look very nice. Now don't worry too much if these are just sitting up a tiny bit like that, even on your roof. As these get hot, they will lay flat and they will stick together. I'm going to complete the remainder of the ridge. When I get to the end, I'm going to show you how to do the end, because there's a little bit of a technique there. Nothing fancy, but it's good to know. So I'll finish this now and we'll get to that shortly. Okay, we've gotten to the end here. In a second, I'm going to show you how to finish that off. Right now, I just want to show you that if you snap a line and you follow all the way down, you get a perfectly straight ridge, as you can see. The other thing too, if these are all put in properly, if you tap on the top, it should be nice and solid. Shouldn't be any hollowness there. You'll see these are a little bit loose right now. Again, those will melt, and or the tar strip underneath will melt, and they will bond together. So next, let's go over here, and I'll show you how to finish off the end. Okay, we're at the end of the roof, and we're going to be putting on our last ridge caps here. There's two ways to do this. This is one way where you cut a piece with your exposure, you cut this piece to length, you wrap it over, nail it like you would the other ones, and then finish off on the end here with a piece that gives you a 5-inch exposure as well and is flush with the end here. And then this piece, you would nail it here and here. Can't go too far because we've got our inch overhang. Then you would tar over top of those nails just to hide them and to weatherproof them. The other way you can do this is you can reverse this last piece like that. Now you'll notice that we have two tar strips now, and you can put this piece and try and balance it out for your exposure. You can put this piece on like this, and you can put a nail here and a nail there and do the same thing on this side. That gives you double strips to adhere this as the sun heats it up. So either way is fine. I prefer doing it this way, but you can do it either way you want. So I'm going to finish that off. Line it up. I already cut this piece to length, so I know it fits. When you're bending these over too, if they're tight on both sides, it's usually a good indicator that you're positioned right. It's also, then you know it's nice and tight, no hollow spots. So we take our last piece, line it up, make sure it's flush. Before you put the second nail in, just get it lined up on this side. And just dab a little bit of black tar on there. If you have a colored roof, brown or green or whatever color, you should be able to get a suitable sealant that's color matched or close to the same color. If you just have dark gray or black shingles, tar will do just fine. That's all there is to it. We are done with the roof, but I do want to go over a few things, recap, so to speak, excuse the pun. Okay, we finished our roof caps. One thing I didn't show you is on the end here, the second cap is a little higher because it's sitting on the first cap. You can, if you like, put a starter strip in here, the width of your exposure, and that will lift this up just a bit and give this last, or the first cap, the same appearance underneath as the remainder of your caps. So if you want to do that, go ahead. I just want to do a recap on the roof, the whole roof process in general, just quickly. Number one is when you're starting with your roofing felt, go with 30 pound, don't go with 15, it's too light. 30 pound, when you put it on, try and get your shingles on top and finished before the felt gets wet. If the felt gets wet, it can start to get wavy, and that can, in some cases, transpire through your shingles or cause your shingles to have the same effect. If you live in an area where you may have to work when it is raining or a little bit drizzly, then there's other materials that you can buy for underlayment that won't do that. Fiberglass-based, plastic-based, well, sort of plastic, new compounds these days. So keep that in mind when you do your felt or your underlayment. And then when you start your shingles and you're doing your roofing, it's really important that you don't do it in too hot a weather. Shingles get very pliable when they get really hot. They tear easy. They're messier. They're harder to cut. They're also, if you're working on the roof and it's hot, the surface of your shingles can damage much easier if you're stepping on them. So cooler weather is better. The same applies if you're working in really cold weather. The shingles get brittle, so they crack easy. So cold weather can be problematic as well. So starting early morning, and then going later in the day, starting later in the day again, if it's really hot, probably isn't a bad idea. The other thing, you'll notice when I was chalking out the lines that I did my vertical lines. And the vertical lines, when you're using three-tab shingles, is really important because you want all your lines on your shingles lining up when you look up the roof. So by doing those vertical lines, we achieve that. Horizontal lines assure that our roof is straight when you're looking down it this way. You'll notice that I marked off several vertical lines. You can do it that way. I prefer to do it that way. I find it more accurate. But you can also, once you have your first two lines, just measure 6 inches with these particular shingles because they're 12 inches on center. And so you don't have to mark them all, but that's up to you. You'll also note if you're working with these type of shingles, the three-tab shingles, and you're lucky enough that you can start with a full shingle and then cut off half a shingle and work across your roof that way. If you can do that, you take a look at the back of the shingle in this next picture, you'll see I've pointed out that there's some pre-marked measurements that are dead center of each shingle. And the GAF product we're using has those. You may find it's probably pretty common with other products that they'll have the same thing, and that makes it very easy for cutting and setting up your runs. So that's another thing to take a look at. Other than that, I'm just going to take the camera underneath and show you that by using our spacing strip here, which was 1 inch, that we ended up with a very nice clean roof line. And just take a look at that now. Other than that, we are done with the roof. Next thing we'll be doing is the door video, how to install the door. And following that, we'll be doing the trim video.